Welcome to worship today with Trinity Presbyterian Church in Springfield, Missouri. I'm Pastor Chris Miller, and I'm glad you're here with us for worship today. If this is your first time joining us for worship, thank you for spending some of your time with us today. If you'd like to learn more about the mission and ministry of Trinity, please visit us online at trinityspringfieldpcusa.org. Today, I want to thank everybody who came out and supported our October curbside food drive. You came through in a big way, like you always do. Not only did we collect several hundred pounds of food for our food pantry partners across lines, we also collected over 120 personal care items, nail clippers and hairbrushes, and 538 pairs of hot hands hand warmers. Those go to support our homeless outreach partners at Grace United Methodist. That's enough stock to keep them going almost, if not all the way through this coming winter season. Remember, our next curbside food drive will be Monday, November the 9th, so make plans to come by. We'll have more details in the newsletter when it gets closer. Speaking of coming by the church, over the next 3 days, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday, I'll be handing out complimentary copies of No Innocent Bystanders. It's the book we're using for our congregation-wide study on how each of us can become allies in the work for justice in our community. The times this week are this Sunday, the 18th, from 10:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m., Monday, October 19th, from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m., and then Tuesday, the 20th, from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. I hope you can come by during one of those three times so I can hand you a book and our reading guide. But of course, if you need any more information, it's in the newsletter this past week. It'll be in there again next week, and you can find it on our website at the link below. Finally, I want to remind you about our Trinity Cares face masks and show you a sample. They came in just the other day. You can see they're this lovely gray color, and it says Trinity Cares with a PCUSA cross on it. Some of them, like this one, are ear loop style masks. There are others that have loops that go around the back of your head. That's the kind I prefer. But whichever style you want, you can pick them up for $10 each. $4.55 of every 10 goes directly to support our ministry partners at Rare Breed Youth Outreach. You can go online, the link's right down here, to order your Trinity Cares face mask. Friends, please consider, we know how important masks are. This is a great way to keep everybody safe while also promoting Trinity a little bit in our community. Friends, it's good to be with you today. Let us turn our hearts and minds to the worship of God. In Paul's first letter to the church in Thessalonica, he extends his greetings, saying, "Give thanks to God for the faith we share. Be steadfast in hope through Jesus Christ." In that same steadfast faith, today let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ, you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We sing to God our first hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory.
God of grace and God of glory, on thy people pour thy power. Crown thine ancient church's story, bring its bud to glorious flower. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, for the facing of this hour. For the facing of this hour. Lo, the host of evil round us scorn thy Christ, assail his ways. From the fears that long have bound
faith and praise. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the living of these days. For the living of these days. Save us from weak resignation to the evils we deplore. Let the gift of thy salvation be our glory evermore. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, serving thee whom we adore. Serving thee whom we adore.
Each week in our worship service, we come before God and each other to confess our sin and the sin of the world. When we are able to clearly see the places where we're separated from each other, from God, then it's easier for us to articulate the ways in which we need to work to heal that separation. We need not fear admitting our sin, admitting our brokenness, for the proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in Jesus, we turn to him. We approach God with confidence. Trusting in God's grace, let us together confess our sin. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. As we continue in this time of prayer, I invite you to extend your own personal prayers of confession, entrusting yourself to the grace of God. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Friends, hear the good news of the gospel. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone and a new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. We turn now to our children's sermon.
Hey, friends, Youth Pastor Reed here. This is Sokka. I've talked to you about him before, and I wanted my message to be a little Sokka-related, but hopefully related to your life as well. So, Sokka is not always nice to his little sister. He can play with her kind of rough. In fact, right now, she's sleeping away from him, because he kicked her in the face, which was not very nice. But, you know, Sokka's going to forgive his sister, and his sister is, more importantly, going to forgive him, because, well, that's what they do. They don't really hold things against each other, do they? No, they love each other a lot. You know, I think I could learn a lot from cats. And I think I do learn a lot from my cats. Because sometimes when I get mad at someone, I really don't like them afterward. If I'm playing something and they're mean, I don't want anything to do with them. And I wonder if we would be happier, and more like how Jesus would want us to be, if we could be kind of like these cats here. And learn to forgive our friends when they do things that hurt us, or forgive our family when they do things that we think they shouldn't. So it's something to think about. How can you let go of something that you're mad about and learn to forgive someone else? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear what you say to us today. Amen. Our first scripture reading today comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Listen for God's word for you today. Paul, Silas, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. The Thessalonians' faith and example. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers constantly, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and the Lord, for in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming.
Your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. Remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus. Dance for Jesus. Dance for Jesus and live. With your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live.
For a second reading today, we turn to the Gospel according to Matthew, the 22nd chapter, verses 15 to 22. We pick up right where we left off last week with the story of an unexpected banquet. We now turn to a bit of conflict in Jesus' day. Listen for God's word to you and to us this day. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this? Whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then Jesus said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As we stand in the midst of an election season unlike any of us have ever known, what does the lectionary do but bring us a passage on our duty to God and country? Lucky pastor. In our passage today, Jesus is faced with two groups of questioners. On one side, you have the Pharisees, the devout, pretty intense, law-abiding Jews. These are the religious perfectionists of their day. On the other side, you have the Herodians. They are political allies of Herod and allies of the occupying Roman Empire. Matthew makes it pretty clear in this passage, these ideological opponents who would have had nothing in common otherwise have a common purpose in today's story, to entrap Jesus by making him answer an either-or question by putting him in a no-win situation. If Jesus says that a tax is, if he answers yes, the tax is okay, then the Pharisees can accuse him of blasphemy. After all, the denarius, the coin that they hand him, it has a graven image of Caesar on it, stamped onto the coin, along with a statement that basically claims that Caesar is divine, is the son of God. So to pay this tax is to use a blasphemous instrument. And the Pharisees can turn the religious folks against Jesus. But if Jesus says that no, it's not okay to pay the tax, then the Herodians can turn and claim that he is guilty of sedition and treason, that he's trying to overthrow the country. And they can hand him over to the officials. Jesus is upsetting the power, upsetting the balance of power in Jerusalem. And both the religious and political powers decide that it's better if he is out of the picture. They team up, two groups that would never have worked together normally, to figure that whichever side he takes, the other can take him out. They intend to put Jesus in a no-win situation. They approach him with flowery words, but Jesus sees right through it. Matthew tells us he is aware of their malice, their ill intent, and he has no intentions of playing their game. His response leaves them in amazement. He slips through their trap. Give to Caesar what is Caesar. Give to God what is God's. Now, there is a safe way of preaching this passage. I want you to step back in time with me for a moment. Can we imagine that we are somewhere in the mid-20th century in an American mainline Protestant church? Think it's 1950-something. Maybe you watch a family walk in the door, the stereotypical suburban family, a husband, the housewife, 2.5 kids, and the dog. Everyone goes to church, minus the dog, of course, and they put on a real good show. They're well-dressed, well-behaved, all-American. As the saying went, you went to church on Sunday, because if you didn't, you'd hear about it on Monday. In this world of mid-20th century America, there was only one interpretation of this scripture. Keep anything remotely political out of church. We don't want to make people uncomfortable because, remember, it's just as easy for them to be a Methodist as it is a Presbyterian. People come to church for the choir and the organ and the coffee. They want to be reassured that they're good people. They want to be seen by the right people. They're not here to be made uncomfortable by political talk. The safe reading of this passage is to reassure us that our lives have different parts, different buckets. The God part is over here. The political part, well, that's over there. The family part lives kind of back in that corner, and the job part, it's over here. You get the idea. It's like those plates that we get at church suppers that have the little sections in them to make sure that the gravy never touches the peas. Everything just stays in its own little area, not bothered or influenced by anything else. The problem with the safe reading, though, the problem with the safe approach to this sermon, is that's not how our lives are supposed to work. We're not supposed to be boxed up and isolated, keeping one part of our lives totally separate from all the other parts. We're supposed to bring the best of all that we've got to bear in everything that we do. Our faith should have an impact on our roles outside the church. Our career, our family, our social life, our hobbies, and yes, even our politics. One of the problems with the safe reading of this passage is that by saying, well, we never talk about politics in church, it quickly becomes a shorthand way of dismissing conversations that make us uncomfortable. Someone brings up a conversation about a policy decision the city has made that's impacting our homeless community, and someone can say, well, we don't talk about politics in church. Someone could raise a question about how our nation deals with discrimination against LGBTQ folks. And we can say, well, we don't talk about politics in church. We can raise any number of issues from immigration to healthcare to education. And each time, instead of considering what the gospel has to say, we say, well, no. We don't talk about politics in church. And if we keep repeating that refrain over and over, eventually it makes it impossible for the church to deal with real-world issues of faith. We see a clear example of this playing out in Dr. Martin Luther King's famous Letter from Birmingham Jail, in which he responds to the criticisms of a group of white church leaders, including a Presbyterian. Dr. King's powerful letter clearly and directly names the inaction of the white church on issues of segregation, civil rights, and racial injustice as a source of pain for Black Americans, a way that our community was driven apart and hurt. This inaction by the white church, I would contend, is not because the white church was inherently racist, but because we had this belief that politics have no place in church. And so to talk about issues of civil rights wasn't a faith conversation. That belonged somewhere else. And it kept us from preaching justice and hope. It kept us from the work of the gospel. Of course, there are problems with mixing politics and religion. Myriad issues arise. I just want to name one of them. When religion is co-opted by partisan forces, both are damaged. To claim that to be a good Christian means blindly voting for one political party or another is to marginalize the role of faith in determining the best path for our common political life. Just as saying we don't talk about politics in church is the way to shut down conversation, so is saying, well, everyone knows that anyone who is a good Christian votes blank. So then the question becomes, what is the Christian's faithful response to politics, especially in days like ours, where our nation is so divided? First, I would share my belief that our primary loyalty is to Jesus Christ and the kingdom of God, not to a political party or a particular candidate. Truth is found in the Word of God, fully revealed in Jesus Christ, not in political platforms or campaign promises. Second, we remember that our hope does not come from the outcome of elections. It comes from the free and redeeming mercy of God. Simply put, the kingdom of heaven is on its way. Nothing will stop it. That is good news. Third, we know that Scripture calls each of us to seek the good of the city in which we find ourselves. We are to work to make where we live better. We're to make this city better, this state better, this nation better. We are to work for justice through all means possible. Therefore, I think it is appropriate for Christians to engage in political discussion, advocate for political policies, and participate fully in the political realm of our world. And during each of those things, we should bring the fullness of our faith to bear. Part of that is doing it with love and grace, knowing that the truth of the kingdom is more than any political party, more than any one race. And so allowing one race, one party to divide or destroy our community is not the will of God. As we make political decisions, we should ask, does this policy or this candidate reflect the values of the kingdom of God? When we choose who to vote for, we should consider which person best reflects the principles of serving the least of these in Matthew 25. Scripture tells us time and again that God is concerned with those that protect the welfare of the vulnerable and marginalized. The Old Testament commonly and repeatedly references faithful people are those who protect the orphan, the widow, the poor, the outcast, and the foreigner. That list of people. Our choices in the ballot box should reflect those priorities too. For so long, we have avoided talking about politics because we don't want to be uncomfortable. And I get it. I don't like being uncomfortable, and I don't like being in situations where I can tell other people are uncomfortable. But if we are going to build a nation where the promise of liberty and justice for all is more than just a nice-sounding slogan, Friends, we gotta talk to one another. We have to sit down and have conversations beyond just, well, are you voting red or blue? We're gonna have to talk about the changes that we want to see in our country that will make us more like the kingdom of God. What direction do we need to move? It's more than political parties. It's more than specific candidates. And the call of today's reading is to do just that. Set aside our comfort or discomfort and our either-or way of thinking. Just like Jesus didn't choose between what the Pharisees said and what the Herodians said, we can be more nuanced as well. In all of it, we are to live the way Jesus commands. Simply put, we need to love God and love each other with all we've got, heart, soul, mind, and strength. And in that, we will find hope. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We turn now to our morning's offering. God has told us what is good and what does the Lord require, but to do justice, love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. I invite you to participate with the financial life of Trinity through the sharing of your gifts. You can find information on how to give through our website, trinityspringfieldpcusa.org. Let us worship God with our morning's offering.
We're going to do a song called A Place in the Choir. It was written back in the 70s, and a lot of folks have covered it since then. We learned it when a good friend of ours named Jim Moles did it with the kids at our church up in Terre Haute, Indiana. And we liked it so much, we want to share it with you.
All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing higher, some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Listen to the bass, it's the one on the bottom where the bullfrog croaks and the hippopotamus moans and groans with a big to-do, and the old cow just goes moo. Dogs and cats, they take up the middle where the hummingbird hums and the cricket fiddles, and the donkey brays and the pony neighs, and the old coyote howls. Listen to the top where the little bird sings all the melody, with the high notes ringing and the hoot owl hollers over everything, and the jaybird disagrees. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing higher, some sing out loud on the telephone wire, and some just clap their hands or palms or anything they got now. Singing in the nighttime, singing in the day, the little duck quacks and he's on his way. The possum ain't got much to say, and the porcupine talks to himself. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing higher, some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. It's a simple song, a living song everywhere, by the ox and the fox and the grizzly bear, the grumpy alligator and the hawk above, the sly raccoon and the turtle dove. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing higher, some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. All God's critters got a place in the choir.
Let us turn our hearts to God in prayer. Let us pray. God of wisdom and love, giver of all good things, we thank you for your loving kindness and for your constant care over all creation. We bless you for the gift of life, for your guiding hand upon us, and your sustaining love within us. We thank you for friendship and duty, for good hopes and precious memories, for the joys that cheer us and the trials that teach us to trust in you. We bless you for Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, for the living presence of your Spirit, for your church, the body of Christ, for the ministry of word and sacrament and all the means of grace. In our weakness, you are strength. In our darkness, light. In our sorrows, comfort and peace. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God glorified forever. In glad thanksgiving for your goodness, we offer you our gifts and pray for the power to offer and present our very selves to you as a living sacrifice, dedicated and fit for your acceptance. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We sing to God our final hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Friends, whatever you do this week, do it all in the powerful name of the Triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God Almighty be on you this day and all your days. Amen.
All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing higher, some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or pause.